going on and what needs to be done. And this is designed in such a manner that every state will have a chapter of the police foundation, and it is actually the police exists at the state level, and so every state should have an ideating platform, and every state should have a chapter, and that's how it has been designed. And in fact, the way it has been designed, we want to work very closely with the BPR and the NPA and other training centers so that we can be whatever little assistance or support that we can be of, we can give. And also try and bring the conversation to the larger citizens' space. In fact, for the information of this August group, we are also launching a parliamentary forum to discuss reforms in the police and in the criminal justice system. And we have been generally contacting some of the parliamentarians to come together, irrespective of the political parties, so that this can be the discourse can be taken to the larger political arena. Because after all, police reform can take place only with the support of the political parties in a democracy like ours. Now, on police reform, I just want to say that what we are looking at is the grassroots level policeman, the constable, the sub-inspector, the thana. That is where we need to focus, and the Police Foundation is trying to focus there to see whatever can be done, whatever ideas can be generated for improving the quality of policing in our country. So, which means a lot of internal reforms. Ultimately, no politician or no bureaucrat is going to come and reform your police. Police reform has to happen only if police officers take the leadership. Only if police officers want, there can be reform, and we can't blame, because in many of our discussions I see that the refrain is that no IAS officer wants reform or no politician wants reform. But it is not their job to reform the police, it is the job of the police leadership. So that is the ultimate theme of the Police Foundation. So about 2 years back, I will refrain from touching upon the public perception part of it, which has been very eminently dealt with by Mr. Rajiv Rai Bhatnagar. So I will not speak about that. So about 2 years back, we have been working on a small paper on the need for standardization for police services. And I happened to submit a proposal, a comprehensive proposal was submitted to the Ministry of Home Affairs. And recently I also submitted a copy of that to the BPRND. And so I will briefly touch upon the salient features of that scheme, which of course this is only based on secondary research and other things, and we need to refine this proposal further, because it's not that one person or one or two persons can do this. This can happen only if a larger number of police officers and researchers, academic researchers, come together. In fact, sir, Mr. J.K. Sinha was himself, they had started this concept of a police think tank along with Mr. Dhirendra Singh, the then Home Secretary. But somehow it did not move forward. And I came to know about this very recently, much later, after we started this this project. So this scheme that I am going to tell you briefly about is about the the need for standardization and a broad, you know, the contours of a standardization scheme. So it is about benchmarking police management and police service delivery. So why prescribe minimum standards? So Mr. Shekhar Gupta is with us. There will be a formal welcome for you. But, so I'll continue with my brief presentation. So the need for prescribing minimum standards. Because if our public perception, which is the main theme of this today's discussion, if that has to be improved, we need to make sure that our own personnel and their quality, the quality of the personnel as well as the quality of our service delivery, these have to be scrutinized from an independent point of view. So we have to make sure that police refrains from indiscriminate and careless use of police powers. They have to be, these police powers should not be exercised carelessly. So that is one of the reasons for the need for standardization. Setting clear goals for accessibility and responsiveness and promoting a policing culture which is positive and with the ultimate aim of maximizing citizen satisfaction. Policing is the foundation of justice and the rule of law. And it is important that this is protected from the mood swings of police officers who happen to sit on the chair. Because very often, very capricious kind of decision making is done by police officers without following any kind of standards in mind. So we need to protect our operations from mood swings. So policing standards that we are talking about is a set of very clear criteria with explicit metrics and indicators that define a range of quality standards, that is measurable indicators. At least in the beginning stage, we should have them at reasonably achievable levels at the beginning stage with clear measurable criteria which can be monitored and measure. So this will have two stages. Number one stage is about setting the standards, and number two is about an accreditation scheme by following a certain kind of review or assessment of how each police unit is performing. So it's a performance assessment of the state police or the district police, as the case may be. So these two steps or stages are there. First, briefly about the standard setting part. So we should initially at least identify some of the core policing areas and identify what are the critical elements which need to be standardized in the first stage. We can broaden this later, but to begin with, let us confine ourselves to some of the critical or what may be called core policing areas and identifying best practices, etc., etc. But this will involve two or three committees. What I have suggested is that at the BPR&D level, there should be two or three committees. One is a basic level committee for setting up the the drafting committee, and then a review committee by a technical thing, and an approval committee by senior officers of BPR&D. And once these committees do, you know, approve these standards. These standards at the before the approval level, they can be put on the you know, websites of BPRND and others. And finally, once, you know, this has to be done by a committee, a multidisciplinary committee of experts, and after a good deal of deliberations and considerations. And finally, once these, we have about, let's say, 100 standards which are published, then an independent agency will handle the review process. The review process should be done by a set of experts drawn from multiple disciplines and who are known for not only their professional expertise but also for their integrity, and they will assess the level of you know, compliance by each police organization, and based on that level of compliance, based on that assessment, they will assign, I mean, various kinds of grades. And this is the broad principle that, because I am told that the time is up, so I will not go into greater details of this, but we have the contours of a standardization process and an accreditation process, which can be, to begin with, this can be a very good way of, you know, this is one way of making sure that police officers keep striving, you know, to raise their bar, to make sure that they, you know, our, for example, let me tell you, in the police culture, we have this inspections, but the inspections, the so-called traditional inspections, have not been able to make much of a difference as far as this purpose is concerned. But we have to have very clearly articulated standards and very clear metrics and practices to measure how each police organization is measuring up to each standard, and then have a broad you know, classification like A plus, A minus, B, etc. And if any police organization is has already reached A plus, they will continue to strive to retain that A plus. But if somebody is at B minus, then they will have to be told that you have to do these things to come up to B plus or to the next level. So this will be a continuous nudging towards you know, professional excellence, and that is the entire purpose of the this scheme. So if there are questions subsequently, I am willing to answer them. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Ramachandran. I request Mr. DGP BRND to present Mr. Shekhar Gupta with a plan. Ladies and gentlemen, a brief introduction of Mr. Shekhar Gupta. He's a founder and editor-in-chief of The Print, a digital startup building a new editorial space of non-hyphenated liberalism, neither left nor right, liberal on society, liberal on economy. He's a prolific columnist with the highly influential column National Interest, which is translated into 7 languages. A selection of these columns were collected in the best-selling book, Anticipating India. Shekhar, a recipient of the Padma Bhushan, host off the cuff, an offering from The Print, we see him in conversation with an eminent guest twice a month. He also hosts Walk the Talk on NDTV 24/7 every week. A collection of his news-making interviews has been published recently as a book, Walk the Talk, Decoding Politicians. In his 4-decade career, Shekhar has reported on key Indian and international events, including the Nelly massacre in Assam, Operation Blue Star, the student uprising in Tiananmen Square in Beijing, the fall of the Berlin Wall, the first Gulf War from Baghdad, the first US-backed jihad in Afghanistan, and the many twists and turns in the troubled 1983-1993 decade in Sri Lanka's Tamil Nadu. Before this, Shekhar served as editor-in-chief of the Indian Express for 19 years and simultaneously held the position of the company chief executive for 13 years. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome Mr. Shekhar. I invite you, sir.
Thank you very much. I just had the pleasure of being presented a potted plant by Mr. Maheshwari, and a thought came to my mind that there's always a tussle between police and the press. Police wants to plant stuff on the press. So if this is one way police will give me a plant, I will happily take it. I think any other way might be a little bit of a problem. Sir, thank you very much. What a thoughtful gesture. It's a great idea, this seminar. And I think I'm very privileged that you asked me, you allowed me to intrude into this, because this is very much a gathering of professionals. Sometimes it's better to have an outside element to come and at least get the immune system to react a little bit, because all immune systems react to outside elements. Now, I'm looking at the subject of this session and other sessions also, but this session in particular. Our country has come to a very strange state now. I'm not saying we are better than before or worse than before. Maybe we are better than before, or maybe as the Americans say, when Americans choose between presidential candidates, they say, why are you voting for Obama and not for whoever was against him at that point? Or why are you voting for Hillary and not for Trump? They say, because she is less worse than Trump. They don't say she is better. So I think we've come to a situation in our country where it'll be tough to say better or worse, but maybe less worse than before. And one of the reasons I say less worse than before, from the citizen's point of view, is that citizen has access to more information now. Citizen is more empowered. Today, earlier, if a policeman gave you trouble, if a policeman did not register your complaint, if a policeman asked you for money, you had to write a letter to somebody's higher up, and that will go into thanda basta with, you know, hundreds and thousands of other such things, and somebody will say, take action, and then it will disappear. You go to the Prime Minister, Chief Minister. Today, you can tweet, right, and tag 3, 4, 5 people. This country, I can tell you this, starting with the Prime Minister, there's nothing people in power read more carefully than Twitter. I've now been told that, in fact, my friend Arun Shori told me that jinne marzi lambe lambe editorial likhi jab koi asar nahi hoga. Ek aadhe tweet se kya ja kar kuch. Say something on a tweet, that will be taken seriously. So that power now the citizen has. So that power of being shout and being able to heard by directing the message in the right place is what has made the situation less worse than before. So some of the things which could be done in the past can no longer be done. The second problem is we've become very minimalistic in our expectations of people. So we'll say, ji, wo judge bada bekar judge hai. Usne kya ghatiya se ghatiya stupid judgments diye hain, usko argue karna nahi aata. Sir, hai imandar. Right? I mean, a judge is supposed to be imandar. I mean, has it now become a special qualification ke judge imandar hai? Ye hai imandar. Are imandar ka kya fayda agar us innocent aadmi ko phansi pe chada diya? We had Justice Kaju, right? Rose to the Supreme Court of India. See what fame he has made of himself later. Now I want to go back and check what kind of orders and judgments has he been writing, right? Nobody does it. I'm deliberately talking about judiciary, not about the police, because police the usual suspects hain. Police ka naam to log badnaam karte hi hain. I mean, we've had a judge in Jaipur who said on his last judgment, ki ji mor kitna chaste hai, ki morni sirf uske aansu and gets pregnant or bache paida karti hai. Forget the fact that he thinks that peacocks procreate by one pecking at the other's tears, but also note the fact that he thinks that morni bache deti hai, morni to ande deti hai, right? A peacock is not a mammal, but the fact is the man was a judge for 5 years, maybe before that also, I don't know where he came from, maybe he was a Sessions Judge, a district judge. How many people he may have hanged? Nobody knows. A third judge just yesterday has come out of jail. The first High Court judge in India's history to go to jail, and that too for a professional misdemeanor, for contempt of court. He was a senior judge in a High Court. I'd like to see how many orders has he been giving in his legal life. All this while, so what kind of justice has been done to whom? But very often in this case also, Rajasthan ke sab aadmi imandar tha. So you hear that this about the police, you hear this about journalists. Ji wo likhe kitna bewakoof hai, bolne mein boring hai, uske views are tede-mede hai, par facts theek hote hai. The fact is that, you know, a journalist, the basic requirement in journalism is to get your facts right. The rest can follow, but get your facts right. Your Narayan Murthy always says, Narayan Murthy of Infosys, in God we trust, the rest of you bring data. So facts to lahi hai, to humara kaam hai data lana. Humara kaam ye nahi ke jo marzi idhar se laya, udhar se laya. Maine suna tha, sunne mein aata hai, right? But so much of sunne mein aata hai is now getting into the media. Respectable publications will say, I can't find no evidence, but even if a fraction of what I hear is correct. That people can say that a journalist, if his facts are usually correct, he's a very good journalist. So that is our minimalistic expectation from everybody. So minimalistic expectation of a policeman now among people is not that he should not be corrupt. That is too high an expectation. Very few. The minimalistic expectation is that he should not harass me. And we don't see it in Delhi, because in Delhi, all of us are VIPs, not just people who are well-connected, but even an ordinary person in Delhi is a VIP. Because har kisi ki sunwai hai, MLA hai, municipal councillor hai, har kisi ko Twitter pata hai, Facebook pata hai, itne sare newspapers hai, TV channels hai, aap kisi ko do chhapad galat marenge, to seedha TV channel mein jata hai wo. Even before the swelling goes down on his cheek, right? So, but across the country, police is seen as the most brutal instrument of state power. And it's not even an instrument of state power in the sense, say, the army might be an instrument of state power. It is seen as an instrument of state power in the sense of who controls the state today. So when a state government changes, everything can change. And everything does change. So I will tell you a story from a gentleman who is now in jail, serving a 10-year sentence, Mr. Om Prakash Chautala, for corruption. When he was chief minister once, he said, I love politicians because they are the most fun Indians and they are the most hardworking Indians. And they are in some ways intellectually the most honest. Because they chori bhi karte ho, to sach bolte hain. So he once called me for dinner because he takes great pride in the fact that I am a fellow Haryanvi. So, and he always calls me Gupta Sahab, surprise, funnily. But so he said, Gupta Sahab, ek baat batao. आपने कभी मेरे से ये नहीं पूछा कि हम लोग राजनीति में क्यों आते हैं? क्यों आते हैं? उसने कहा, देखिए, जब सत्ता आती है ना, बाकी नशा वाशा सत्ता के सब तो ठीक है, लेकिन जब सत्ता जाती है तो दूसरा आदमी आपको परेशान करता है और आपके लोगों को परेशान करता है. पुलिस को इस्तेमाल करके हर किसी के खिलाफ केस कर दिया, या किसी का कुछ काम होता है पुलिस में, वो जाता है काम कराने के लिए, उसको बोले तुम तो चौटाला के आदमी हो, तुम्हारा काम नहीं होगा. फिर हम किसी को बोलते हैं कोई हमारी सुनता नहीं है. फिर हम मेहनत करते हैं कि हम सत्ता में आएंगे. फिर हम सत्ता में आते हैं, फिर जो हमारा विरोधी होता है हम उसके सब के ऊपर केस लगा देते हैं. फिर वो जाता है अपने नेता के पास, ये मुझे बचाओ. नेता कहता है, भाई मैं कैसे बचाऊं, मेरी कोई सुनता नहीं. जब वो ये कहता है ना, वो तड़पता है, तब हमारे को बहुत मजा आता है. उसी के लिए हम 5 साल मेहनत करते हैं सत्ता में आने के लिए. सो दिस इज ही man who was honest enough to say so, but this is the story of every state. Everything in India has been reformed to a great extent. Our business and economy has been reformed. License quota Raj is gone. Now the banking system is being reformed. I can tell you that, you know, I'm by no means not critical of this government almost every day, but in one area I will tell you they've really cleaned up the Government's Act. Banks are no longer getting phone calls from Delhi to say, iska loan de do, usko loan maaf kar do, iski evergreening kar do. Wo pehle hota tha, band ho gaya hai. So many of these areas are being cleaned up. Higher education is being cleaned up.
medical education, there is a new law coming up. Cricket is being cleaned up, right? It is being reformed. But two areas in India are not being reformed. And frankly, they are going to be the toughest to reform. What are those two areas? One is land, and second is policing. Because land and law and order are under the state government's control. Abhi aapne unse taxes to le liye GST se. Now, if you take away land also, now can you imagine what finances India's politics? What finances India's politics is no longer industrial licensing, it's no longer quotas, it's no longer export-import permits. Wo to sab chala gaya. The only thing, what mainly finances India's politics is land. So, since I know area around Delhi well, say in Gurgaon, just beyond Gurgaon, you can buy an acre of land from a farmer for 30 lakh rupees. You can buy 10 acres of lands, you can buy 100 acres of lands, you can buy 1,000 acres of lands in different parcels. You can set up a company and buy that agricultural land. Then, if you go to the chief minister, by one stroke of pen, that chief minister can declare that land to be a hospital, to be commercial, to be residential, to be educational, to be residential. I'm looking at the hierarchy at which the value goes up. So if he declares it to be residential, the value of 50 lakhs per acre goes up to maybe 50 crores an acre. Because he will make it residential and give you FSI of you can build 30 floors. So when 50 lakhs becomes worth 50 crores, a lot of the arbitrage goes to the political class. So there is no way the political class will allow land to be reformed. A simple solution is, if 200 of our cities and their peripheries were fully zoned, which means you will know yahan hospital ban sakta hai, yahan school ban sakta hai, yahan pe university ban sakti hai, yahan pe housing aayegi, yahan pe commercial aayega, then obviously, then you already know the value of everything. Then when the farmer sells that land, farmer knows that on my land a hospital can come up, or on my land tomorrow a residential complex can come up. So you accordingly get paid for that, arbitrage goes away. That the political class will not allow to happen, and it is not happening, because that's where the money comes from. That's why the pressure on chief ministers of Haryana, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Hyderabad is always great from their parties to produce money, because these are cities around which property is acquired much greater value. The other thing the political class doesn't want to reform is the police. Simply for this reason, as Mr. Chautala said, that when I will be out for 5 years, there will be cases against me. When I will come back, first of all, I have to sort out my own cases, but I also have to fix all the others who had done this to me. And that is the vicious cycle in which the police is caught. Now, it is not as if politicians are sufferers in this. It's not as if honest policemen are the sufferers in this. The common citizen is the sufferer in this. Because in every case that goes left to right, say in Aligarh, Muzaffarnagar, Fatehabad, any place, lots of common people get involved. And governments keep changing and going. The common man file leke court mein jata hai, court se aata hai. I mean, I had to make a court appearance today, that's why I'm a little bit late. Just a minor defamation case. But 3 times I had not gone, so I was afraid that if I don't go again, he may issue NBWs. And this, nothing happens, but the fact is, and I'm looked after. I have a lawyer from my previous employers, it's an old case. I have a car sent for me, somebody makes sure I have a place to sit. Somebody keeps fussing over me, ji, aapke liye chai le aaye, aapke liye coffee le aaye, right? 5-6 log aake selfie bhi khicha lete hain, right? Lekin when an ordinary person goes to court again and again and again and again, and these cases go on forever, and all he has for company is a poor cop who's suffering as much as this person is suffering, because these cases go on and on forever. So I think that is where the big problem comes in. You can do many reformist things, have many ideas. New York has done what is called CompSat, I think they call it. They've used computer programming now to figure out which are the parts of the city which are more prone to crime. They are carrying out more intensive patrolling there. London police is doing their